goal is not to gain information. The goal is not to know things. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 13, if I know all mysteries and have not love, I mean, consider all mysteries. Okay. I don't want to know all mysteries. I want to know the core of what God is like. I want to know what makes him tick. I want to know, not in a psychoanalysis way, as if I can psychoanalyze God. In the eyes of the Lord. I mean, he could have been looking anywhere, but he found it in the eyes of the Lord, and the Lord began to open Noah's eyes to, this is a horrible phrase here because there's so many better ways of saying it, but I'm going to say it, God concepts. Now, here's why I don't like using that, is because we're going to go immediately to divinity. We're going to go immediately to theology. Divinity and theology. Really and truly, when I'm using that, I'm talking about man on the earth, man increasing, violence increasing, and junk increasing. But there's something completely different in God than there is in any man. And here's a thought. That if someone ever saw the heart of God and tried to express it, most people, particularly Christians, would reinterpret that in light of their own understanding. In other words, how in the world are we going to impart these things? And the answer is, the greater purpose. one with him. Not just better for it. They're one with Jesus. And so, this revelation is not a revelation of a mystery. It's a revelation of God. It's a revelation of a safe haven. Who will believe in grace and not in their own merits. All right. So, Noah is this one. He has looked into God's face. God begins to divulge this great plan, this thing about bringing about the end of all flesh. That's the beginning, and that's the shadow form. Did wipe out all flesh other than Noah and the guys in there. It didn't truly wipe out the old nature. It didn't truly deal with self. Just saying that, then when is that going to be? Because look at all the flesh we see around us. Look at all the flesh we see in us. Folks, there is a revelation of the truth, not just a bunch of people believing it's by grace, but finding grace in the eyes of the Lord, looking deeper, let me say it this way, looking deeper from whence cometh this grace. Excuse my King James. To find out, in other words, to find out the source of this grace, to find out why grace, to find out how grace, to find out who grace, discover the depths of what is just God's way if there wasn't a sinner. Just finding those things out. So God begins to speak of God begins to speak of judgment. And upon one group. Upon one group, I'm just going to do it like this. Upon another group, thank you. in. That is, you know, that's why it's there. It is not about being with God unless you're in God. It's not about being for God unless you're in God. And in means what? In union with. Faith in union, and union by grace, as long as we do that, we are always going to be separate, even though we're in. You know what I mean? I mean, we're going to feel separate, and you know what? I don't know that the revelation of Christ in the truest, purest form that came to you about being in Christ, I don't know that that's ever going to take away your feelings of being separate. You know, I mean, I lived in 3 foster homes and then lived in a big orphanage. You feel separate a lot. You don't feel apart a lot. You feel like a boat with no paddle out on the ocean just drifting. So, you know, and many other people feel separate. You know, I remember the one time in the church on Bolivar. May change your feelings temporarily, but you'll have them again. Your feelings are not the truth, and they are not declaring to you the truth. If you listen to your feelings and you say, "This is my source of truth," then you are a dummy. Your feelings are a cruel taskmaster that will run you ragged and will make you feel bad and will talk bad to you and will look down on you. Am I right or wrong? Your feelings, you know, I mean, folks, I get feelings. I can literally feel them in my body and in my arm. I just go, you know, I feel rejection physically. I mean, physically, I can feel it. And I've learned over the years, it's been quite a few years of feeling, and I've learned when I feel those feelings, those are coming from my soul, they're coming from fear. So I'm never going to go by them. Learn to go by what your father says. You learn to go by what your husband says. You go by what your Lord says. You go by the one that you're one with and what they say. That's your life. That's your reality. That's your truth. That's your way. That's your righteousness. That's your peace. That's your hope. That's your... Anybody ever heard these words before about Jesus? He is our peace. He is our hope. He's righteousness. He's our wisdom. He's our wisdom. See, he's our wisdom. Yeah, amen. Thank God. God, turn the camera on me so we can see him say praise God. I'm joking. But I mean, you know, I mean, these things are... These things are wonderful. You know, I mean, that's what they call Jesus, wonderful. His name shall be called wonderful. You know, so that when you see Jesus, you go, hey, wonderful. Come here. remember Paul when he was in prison? He said, I am bound, but the word of God is not bound. Well, where did most of this come from? In the New Testament, letters written from prison by Paul. And they're still going. They're still touching lives. They're still changing it. You know? And they're going, well, we shut this dude up. You know, he only gets, you know, one visitor a month. Well, that visitor would sneak out the letter. You can't stop life. You can't stop truth. You can't stop the reality. The reality, you can't stop it. There's no fear in love. There is no fear in love. You know, that's why we're learning this whole reality in a love relationship, a union relationship, and not just a theological thing. You see the value of that. Praise God. Do you see that? And do you really see the value of it for Noah? Because if he don't get it, he's going to be in this group over here under judgment. So, he's seeing that all flesh is going to be destroyed in shadow form. He's seeing the cross. He's seeing the eternal plan of God. He's seeing God's wisdom in a mystery. Jesus isn't going to come destroy everybody. Jesus is going to come and let them destroy him and rise from the dead. The wisdom of God in mystery. That is, you know, if you've ever searched it out, if you've ever searched out the wisdom of God in mystery in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, it is this land. It is this cross. It is this self-giving reality, because the all I didn't say it wasn't fun. That's not fun. I mean, it's not fun. It's not even sort of fun. It's not even a little bit nice. In fact, it's just, I mean, I know we have people with ear problems right now, so I will not do a primal scream. But I could. be out of here for this. Joke. That's what we're in, but you see how people, oh my God, I don't want to be the last one left because it's going to be really bad. Yeah, so, you know, the poor people that are left in that generation, they get it all. All of the bad stuff, the other people got to live a whole life and then die, and then just go, you know, even if they go to hell, they got to live a pretty good life, but you get hell on earth and hell. Years now, I really haven't drawn us in there because I want us to understand that we are one with Him, so you don't see you in Him. You see Him and you understand that you're one with Him. Is that okay? I really believe it's a better concept. I mean, it helps. When I truly saw that I was in Christ and what that meant, and I saw it from the Holy Spirit, I didn't see me in there. I saw Jesus and I understood I was in Him. And good enough. He's my everything. He claims I'm one with Him. What does it say in the first verse? 1:29-30. But of God are you in Christ. And that not of yourself. You know, I mean, that's basically what it's saying. God puts you there. God says you're there. Okay? God initiated it. God declared it to be true. You know, I mean, He did the work. And then declared it to be true. And all we have to do is believe Him. But it has to be on the basis of, I'm one with you, you're my everything. Therefore, what is true of you is true of me. When you believe it, it begins to flow. I mean, it does flow. It does. But you don't believe it. By saying, okay, Randy just did that, so I believe it. Where's it at? Where's the beef? Where's this, you know, where's the stuff? I mean, I'm not getting it. No, you don't believe and then look for it. That's hope. Believing is having it. Hoping is not having it, but looking for it. Glory to God. Can anybody say glory to God? I just heard a little tiny baby girl go, glory to God. This was the concept. This was the one. I wrote something in my notes here. God speaks of judgment upon one group, but of salvation on another, but only through an ark and not just personal salvation. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to extend the carnal view over here to God spot this guy right here and saying, okay, since you prayed a prayer and asked Jesus into your heart, then you're saved. Let me say two things. I don't believe in a personal salvation, and I do believe in where it says to ask Jesus into your heart. You know, healing, it doesn't say prayer, prayer of healing. It says lay hands on the sick and it shall come. And I freak people out sometimes. They say, would you pray for me? I'm sick. I just lay my hand on them for a few minutes and walk off. And they go, you never did pray. Believe. I'm with you. Noah led Shem, Ham, and Japheth to the Lord. Do you agree? I think what happened was that he was a man of God, and they were his family, and they, back then, they followed their dad, their father. Back then, they, you know, they reverenced him. And so, you know, I've often thought this, that when Noah come walking up, because they didn't see any of this in the heart of the Lord, they didn't see anything in the eyes of the Lord, when Noah come walking up and said, look, God's got this plan, and it involves this great big thing that we're all going to get into, because they didn't know what a boat was. You know? It's just a boat on dry land with no water inside. You know? We're going to build a big old thing, and we're going to get on the inside of it, and it's going to take a long time, about 120 years to build this thing. And then we're going to get two of every animal, we're going to put it in there. And then God's going to wipe everything out. You know, I mean, can you see? You know, Japheth. I never heard a story like that. Dad, you're a knucklehead. That sounds more like Ham, doesn't it? But no, you know, they said, here's what they said. It didn't write it here, but I'll bet you anything, just whatever. They said in their minds, you know, Dad's followed the Lord ever since we've known him, and when he says something, it's probably the Lord. Because he's consistently followed the Lord, and it's been the Lord. So I got a feeling this is the Lord too, no matter how weird it sounds. So I'm shutting off my weird concept, and I'm going with him to build this thing, because if he says it's God, it's God. It's the end of things. And they started working. It wasn't complicated. It wasn't difficult. It was, they were 8 souls. So he didn't lead them to the Lord. He led them in the Lord. You believe it? There was a door. God walked up there and led all of them in. He led them in the Lord, but maybe not to the Lord. Because the real salvation wouldn't be stand out here and for Noah to talk to his kids. You'll be saved from the judgment. That's not right. That's not true. Can I get amen? You got to get in. You got to get in the ark. And that's what he preached. And it talks about not only, you know, him building, but preaching this. There's an ark. There's this thing that I saw in the heart of God, this reality that he's going to do this by being in. And by being in, we're saved. Not just praying the prayer, blah, 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 blah. Oh, Jesus, you know. Oh, Jesus, help me. You know, if you're a sinner, oh, Jesus, help me, and then he grabs you and puts you in him, makes you one with him, then you're saved. There is no salvation outside of being in Christ. Nothing. I'm convinced that there are a lot of people who don't really know all the deep teaching of that believe that they're in union with Christ. And I believe there are sweet little grandmothers that so have the Lord that they just exude him because they are that kind of branch. One that abides in him. And they show Jesus. They don't have to, folks, you don't have to know all the depth of this. I don't know all the depth of this. We will be throughout the eternal ages to come learning the depth of it. Right now, I don't want to get into the depth of it. I want to get into the heart of it. I want to get into Jesus. I want to know understand that your security isn't in the state that you're in right at that moment. You better understand that your security is the heart itself. When your security is His or Him as your security, do you understand what I'm saying? It's Him as your security. You realize I am as secure as He is. If He's not secure, then I got a problem. But how can we believe He's secure, but I'm not? Well, the answer is we feel it separate. We're not seeing ourselves as separate. And feeling separate, you know, let me tell you something. If you go 6 months feeling one, that it's still just feelings, and those feelings will eventually change. Go by the reality of Christ. He made you one. He put you in Him. He's going through the storm. You'll make it through. You know, I always think of the disciples. They got in the boat. Jesus said, "Let us go to the other side." Halfway through, a storm came up. He's asleep in the boat. And they're freaking out. How are you so spiritual? You know what I'm saying? I mean, how are you so spiritual? How can you do that? It's easy. I'm freaking out in many cases more than you. I don't show it when I'm preaching. When I'm preaching, I'm the most powerful man in the world. I am the most interesting man in the world. Oh, but when I'm off and alone and I go through stuff. But you know what? It doesn't matter to me that I go through stuff because the art hasn't changed. Just because I'm changing in my emotions or my feelings or my fears or whatever doesn't change the fact. And so I still have to move off of my feelings when I feel good or when I feel bad. I've said this some time ago, maybe some of you remember, maybe some of you don't. But I can't remember. It's been 20, 30 years since I woke up one morning, just any morning. Well, I take that back. I remember one morning in the last 20 years. That I woke up in the morning and felt good. I mean, really, honestly, felt good. Let's put it this way. I remember when I used to wake up, and I'd wake up and if the sun was shining, it was a pretty day, or the weather was just right, or where I liked, or whatever, I'd get up and I'd go, "Oh, I feel good. It's going to be a good day." Anybody remember that? What He's done to me physically is put me in a situation where when I get up, I'm going to have to get up in the Lord or I'm not going to get up at all. Just roll over, pull this blanket over my head and say, "Get it." In that sense, maybe He knew that I would continue for years and years and years to go by myself. my life. The only good thing I got going for me is Jesus. You know? And how precious is Jesus? And I do say that a lot, no matter what. Well, you know, you don't have to go through what I've gone through. Just stop going by your feet. We always think, well, I need to stop going by my bad feelings. I'm just telling you, stop going by all feelings. Does it mean you don't have feelings? No, you have feelings. So you learn to get up and you say, wow, this is a great day. The sun's shining. It feels really great. This is the kind of day I love. But my true joy is in Christ, and my confidence is based on the stability of his heart. And so I'm not going even by the good feelings I have right now. The Lord. Is that good? You know? Praise God. So, you know, just to close on that, my feelings go off all the time. All sorts of stuff. You would be shocked. And then you would be blessed. You'd be shocked if you did such freakouts come. You'd be blessed to know that I make it through. So far. Now, why will I not make it through? Why should I worry about the future? Because cracks are going to start showing up, not in me, but in him. Or are they? Will he get us through all the way into the new creation? And reality, physical reality. The answer is yes. Yes, he will. All right. Take a break.